Hello, this is Charles Figley. This is the second video log that I'm trying to do it weekly for the Traumatology Institute. This is probably where you found the link. What I want to do today is talk about the compassion fatigue resilience model. It's a model that we've published recently in several publications and discussed the theory, the active ingredients, the definitions of all of these things. But so what I wanted to do is just go through this and share this with you and make some comments. And I'll try to keep track of the time here. 5 minutes is what we're trying to go after. You have to look from time to time. So over here at the left side leads into empathic response. Empathic response is critical for any kind of human services. If you're able to, those services are sensitive to what the client wants and needs, let's say the traumatized person wants and needs. So we always want to know that and to figure out how quickly they need, if they're wanting to change for various reasons, etc. So it's critically important to be able to read that person, to be able to use your empathic abilities to be able to figure out what's going on with them. So this is a real payoff, and I'll talk about this a little bit later. But there are three elements that make up and predict the effectiveness or the quality of the empathic response. The first one is empathic ability. If you don't have empathic ability, then you don't really have to worry about compassion fatigue. But most people do have that ability, and almost everyone in human services does. The other element is empathic concern. So it's a motivation to try to help that person. And sometimes that person is so messed up or reminds us of ourselves at one time so much that we may want to avoid that person. So it's important to recognize that as well and work through that. And then the other, as I disappeared here, is exposure to the suffering. This is something that's very common because you can't really provide an empathic response if you're not responding. So it's important to appreciate and recognize that this is the cost of caring in some ways, because this exposure to the suffering really does have an imprint on your heart and your emotions and your memory. So those three things are associated with the empathic response. Because the empathic response includes empathy and you're thinking through and trying to understand the particular client, you'll see the world from their perspective. That's necessary. To not only to understand, but to demonstrate your understanding of what they have gone through. So empathic response is critically important, but it also leads to a certain amount of demand, emotional demand, stress. So consequently, it adds to the secondary traumatic stress. However, there are a number of things that work to reduce the stress. One of them is detachment, being able to compartmentalize while you're working with the traumatized and be able to follow the protocol, make sure that you are doing the right thing that's ethical and it is the best interest of the client. The sense of satisfaction is also reduces the secondary traumatic stress buildup because it is the reason why we do the work, what we get out of it, appreciation, the sense of satisfaction in our doing a good job and enabling someone to, the traumatized in particular, anyone who's in a crisis to, you know, move to the next step. I'm going to go through these fairly quickly because we only have 2 minutes left, pretty much. A sense of satisfaction, social support, you know what that means, have a robust social support system so that when you go tap the system, they're there and they're able to help you. A self-care plan, recognizing and believing in self-care and doing something about it also reduces the secondary traumatic stress, as does social support. The things that really add to it are prolonged exposure to the suffering, of not taking sufficient breaks, of not allowing yourself to completely unwind at the end of the day. So that is critical, and that definitely adds lots and lots of research to show this, that this adds to secondary trauma. So does traumatic memories. If you're working with a traumatized person and it triggers things inside of you or it reminds you of things that you haven't quite worked out yet, then that's a struggle, and that's going to add to this amount of stress. And then so does, you know, everyday experiences. We just finished Halloween. So there's an extra layer of tasks probably the parents have in taking care of the kids and their various needs. All worth it, of course, gets a lot of a great satisfaction from it, but it still is a drain, but temporarily. There are all kinds of things that happen with regard to the demands of life. That's what life's all about. So all of this then is a conduit into the secondary traumatic stress, and that predicts resilience. So the lower the amount of secondary stress that you have as like your default level, the higher the resilience you're going to have in dealing with it. So there's more capacity here. So hopefully that's useful, and lots of places to find it. Just put in compassion fatigue resilience model, and it will pop up someplace. We've pretty much given it away. And the nice thing about this is that if you're concerned about compassion fatigue, then there's something to do about it, not just waiting for something bad to happen. And this is especially important in terms of self-care. And if you visit the Traumatology Institute, then look for the self-care plan that my wife Kathy developed. And I think you'll be all the better for it. And thanks again for your doing this work of human services. We all appreciate it.